Artificial intelligence. It's been with us for longer than we think. Bank of America's Brian Moynihan says they've been using it for at least 5 years.
We have this thing called Erica, which is a virtual artificial intelligence, virtual assistant, natural language processing, predictive technology that we've been running for 4 or 5 years.
And people like JP Morgan's Jamie Dimon insist that it is transformational.
AI is real. This is not...
Not crypto?
That's not crypto. This is a technology which is staggering.
With AI pioneer Samuel Altman telling Congress...
We think it can be a printing press moment. We have to work together to make it so.
But now there are those who are warning about some of the downsides, with tech veterans like Carly Fiorina agreeing with OpenAI's Samuel Altman that there needs to be regulation.
Big tech has to say, we alone are not in charge, and we alone cannot control this.
And a group of AI industry leaders this week wrote an open letter warning that what they are building could lead to a risk of extinction.
And to take us through some of the possible impediments to generative AI, as well as the risks involved, welcome now Sam Palmisano. He is now the chairman of the Center for Global Enterprise, but of course, for many years, he was the chair and CEO of IBM. So Sam, welcome back to Wall Street Week. Really great to have you here. Let's start, first of all, with exactly how big this generative AI could be. We've seen NVIDIA this week really explode in its market capitalization. Is it overhyped, do you think? Is it as big as people say?
David, well, first of all, thank you for having me. No, I think it's that big. This is transformational technology, but it's early stage. But I mean, I always draw the analogy to the internet, because if you think back where it began, exchanging technical documents around the world in the 70s to what it's become today, 50 years later, a lot happened in innovation and development and regulation and guidance, etc. All that has to happen with generative AI or large language models. But it is that transformational, because like the browser for the internet made it kind of user-friendly for people to actually get in there and look up information or search, this will do the same thing as far as AI is concerned, for people to use natural language to interface to it and get responses that are very much like human being responses.
So if it is transformational, as you say, what are we going to need to have it be that transformational? What are some of the key inputs? Let's start, for example, with microchips. That's what's driving NVIDIA to a large degree, and maybe some other chip manufacturers as well. What is the need there?
Well, basically, this is going to be, it requires massive infrastructure. And today you think about it as hyperscalers is the term, or cloud computing service providers like Amazon, Google, Microsoft, et cetera. Having said that, this is... huge demands on capacity and performance of that capacity, therefore the chips. And the advantage that NVIDIA has is these things, graphical processing units that are called GPUs. Those technologies themselves are much better performers than the classic Intel chip, which is referred to as x86 technology. So fundamentally, you need that level of performance to run this, like these natural language models, because they're so large, the data sets are so large and require so many interconnections that you need the performance to be acceptable to the end user.
One of the things we hear about is energy also. It didn't seem that long ago that we were talking about crypto mining and what a big drain that was for energy. In fact, China really cut back on some of the mining there in China. What is the demand potentially in this transformational generative AI or LLM? What is the demand for energy?
Oh, it's the same as all these large cloud service data centers. I mean, it's massive. I mean, you could model those as if they're nuclear reactors. That's how much energy they consume. Now, there's a lot that can be done. I mean, quite honestly, around the utilization of this infrastructure to cut the energy costs, there's ways you can use green energy to supplement the classical forms of electricity and those sorts of things. But there are lots of techniques associated with how to reduce that, but energy is going to be significant. There's no doubt about it. It already is. I mean, it has been for years in these large, whether they were supercomputers in the old days or now the cloud infrastructure providers, it's the same issue. They require significant amounts of energy.
So, Sam, we've heard an awful lot about the wonderful things that generative AI could bring us, not least of which is increased productivity. There are remarkable projections here of trillions of dollars of increased production because of generative AI. Then we had a letter that came out this week from a group of AI experts, people should know about this, warning about the risks and even saying there's a risk of extinction if we're not careful. Is that overblown?
Well, okay, let me tell you what the risks are. I don't know if it's extinction, but the risks are, quite honestly, this technology makes you feel like you're actually getting something that's correct, you know, right? But it's not. It's not valid. And what it's doing basically at the engineering design is connecting large-scale words together. But there's no checking to the source of the words. There's no fact-checking as to the conclusions these words reach. In some cases, it's a terrific essay that it's prepared. Maybe it's a great book that it's written or a wonderful poem. But at the end of the day, if you need accuracy, and you have to have accuracy, like in healthcare, if you were depending upon your diagnostics, you would not use ChatGPT. I mean, you want to have a doctor or some human of some kind that looked at the conclusion that it reached, even though it probably read all the medical journals like we did in Watson Health. You need some kind of a cognition capability, which it does not have. I think people get confused by what it does have because it's so easy to use. It's very, very attractive. There's no doubt about it. But it needs to be enhanced with some of these capabilities that will address the concerns that are in that article today about worrying about it could be like nuclear warfare in the future. I mean, if you think about applications that could have a short-term impact that you would like to have facts but don't have any facts, take political propaganda as an example of that, or political campaigns. I mean, you'd like to have some facts and all that information, but we all know they don't exist. And I'm not sure that the proponents of all that information really want the facts out there anyway.
Sam, is that risk, is that weakness about actually truth-checking, is that inherent in large language models? Is it inherent in generative AI? Or is it something with new iterations, actually, it could take over itself so it could actually check itself?
What needs to be done is the self-checking, like you said. That does not exist today. I make the argument that the inventors of this technology that are raising all these alarms knew about these alarms, and they could have written some of these checkers, these tracing of the information or transparency of the data into the actual technology itself. Now, however, you know, I understand that they raise the concerns. They are very, very valid concerns. However, if you are the inventor or the guys coming up with this technology, you knew this and you could have prepared for this, but now it has to be done. I mean, it's great technology, it's transformational, but now it has to be done, and it will be done. And there's going to be lots of small, innovative companies that are going to take advantage of that gap and add that capability.
What's the government to do?
It depends, you know, right? This is a great dilemma, and I take you back to the early days of the Internet. I mean, in the early days of the Internet, the government decided to take a light hand of guidance to the Internet, and the reason being that they would like to see the innovation grow and accelerate before they actually put the regulations in place. And they're still trying to do that today as you look at data privacy and those kinds of issues, which are very, very valid issues. And this is the same thing. I think in the beginning, how do you regulate something that you don't know what it is? And we really don't know. We have concerns about what it could be, but that's not what it is today. So my suggestion to the people that are raising all these concerns is they work with, obviously, the technologists, the private sector, the academic universities, government regulations, and come up with guardrails, not regulations. Because once you put this in law or code, it never gets reversed. And I don't think we know enough today to put that in a responsible way, put that in place. I know some of the founders of the technology are calling for that. I understand why they're raising those concerns. However, it's the actual details that matter in this case. And you're trading off innovation because you could solve massive societal problems with this technology. I mean, just think about where we have inadequacies of consistency of quality. Healthcare is a system that doesn't have consistency of quality. Suppose you made everybody an expert in healthcare, how much better we all would be. Education, how much better we all would be. So there's great benefit in the technology. I just think that we ought to approach it in maybe a little more heavier hand than the Internet, but certainly not a heavy-handed regulation that perhaps is existing today in China.